Eric Weinmayer lost his eyesight to a rare eye disease. He was completely blind by the time he was 13. He spent his life and his career coming up with ways to overcome obstacles. My most recent project is a film about him kayaking the Grand Canyon. But the first project that I did with Eric was in 2001 when he attempted Mount Everest. Everest is a huge mountain. The base camp where you start is about 3,000 feet higher than Mount Rainier. The most standard, most commonly used route is up through this icefall. It's 2,500 feet of climbing up a frozen waterfall. And it is a frozen waterfall, and when it does its falling, it does it truly catastrophically. The huge boom and tons of ice that obliterates everything, including anybody that happens to be in the way. And to climb Mount Everest, you have to know suffering. You're cold, your body's going haywire from the altitude, it's miserable, it's scary, and I did say cold. It's kind of a blind person's worst nightmare. This is a part of a trailer from the film that we made in 2001 with Eric when he made his attempt on Everest. And also, this was the first time that a high-definition video camera was taken to the summit of Everest. And of course, the credit for that needs to go to the Sherpas who carried it.
Like that. Sometimes people assume that if you can't see how far you have to fall, you're not afraid. But I sometimes think that falling into the unknown is scarier than falling into something you can see.
Biggie, stop right there. There's a 1 foot crevasse behind you.
Rock!
Some guy, he came in today. He didn't know I was in the tent. He didn't know I was sitting right here. And he goes, "Well, you guys are gonna have a hell of a time getting the blind guy up there. You guys have your work cut out for you."
What was so special to me about that climb was not that we went to the summit with a blind man, but that so many of us were up there with him, so many of his team. It was 19 of 21 members of the team made it to the summit that day because we were able to put aside our own need to summit and get behind Eric's summit. So a little bit about me, enough about my friend Eric. My name is Michael Brown. I've climbed Mount Everest 5 times. Made films on every continent, South Pole, what else? The dopey thing about all my climbs of Everest is that whenever I go up there, you know how it is as photographers, you forget to get a picture of yourself. And Everest is one place on this planet when you go there, you should probably try to get a picture. So I keep screwing that up. And for me, the real satisfaction comes not from climbing to the top of Mount Everest, but to be there with a friend who's blind, who you helped get there, that, it stays with you because happiness fades, but that kind of satisfaction stays with you for a long time. When I started making films, it was kind of a formula. You would find the best athletes and take them to a really exotic place and have them do their sport. It was very extreme and cutting edge, and I was always looking for bigger and bigger risks myself. And in that process, I learned a very big lesson that changed my career direction forever. We were going to be the first Americans to ski down one of the top 14 mountains in the world, the highest. They're over 26,000 feet high. And with us on that expedition was a promising young cinematographer named Dave Bridges, and also the most beloved alpinist of his time, a man named Alex Lowe. And there were nine of us in total. And Alex Lowe is, Max Lowe is here presenting as well, and that's his father. And of course, Conrad Anker was a part of it. And we made a film called The Endless Knot, and I have a clip from the film that tells of the events. Actually, it was 16 years ago yesterday that this happened.
Our expedition to Shishapangma was going according to plan. We were moving quickly to acclimatize, get up the mountain, get into position to make a quick ascent of it, and then ski it. We left camp to go for a hike, Alex and David and I, and we hiked up to this small promontory, and we looked over and we saw Andrew there, and Alex and David were like, oh, let's go over there and visit them and traverse across this. We decided to do that, and that was the decision that changed my life. Avalanche triggered high on the southern slopes of Shishapangma and just kept cascading down and increasing in size and force. It struck us.
I was able to pull myself out from a foot of avalanche debris. I came down to advanced base camp having suffered a broken rib and torn shoulder muscle and several lacerations on my head. The searchers came back about an hour and a half after dark, and we resumed the search.
The accident occurred 8 in the morning, Nepal time, on the 5th of October, 1999, and life had changed. Our two teammates, my best friend, they were gone.
So why do we keep going back to the mountains? I know that for me it's a place that of solace, and I think the one fear that I have, maybe more than death, is the fear of losing the ability to feel what I can only feel in the high mountains, in that sacred place. I've come to realize that there are a few different kinds of risk that you can take, and some are more meaningful than others. And also another thing about cameras, I think cameras are like a time machine. And on this day near the top of Everest, I could kind of reach through my camera into this room and take some energy and bring it back in time to then, and then keep climbing. But the tragedy on Shishapangma really changed how I felt about what I was doing. The adrenaline rushes weren't going to cut it anymore. And I found myself gravitating towards making films that included an element of the human spirit. In the film Light of the Himalaya, we went with eye doctors to Nepal to do cataract surgeries on people in the developing world who otherwise wouldn't be able to get the surgeries. And when we were done with the eye camps, we trekked on in deeper into the Himalaya and climbed this mountain, Mount Chalatsi. It's definitely harder than Mount Everest. In 1995, Kelly Perkins was very close to death. Her heart was failing, and just in the nick of time, she managed to get a heart transplant. And then in 2001, I got an email from her team, and I thought it was a joke, actually, because it was like, a woman with a heart transplant wants to climb a 19,000-foot mountain. Will you go? But I thought that might be also really fun, and we became great friends and ended up going on many more expeditions together to four different continents on six expeditions, and also the North Island of New Zealand. And for me, this is kind of the perfect kind of a expedition adventure, is where I can be hanging on the wall. This is 3,000 feet up El Cap in Yosemite, looking straight down at Kelly. And for me, that's just my ideal kind of place to be. And knowing that also we're telling a story that can go back home. And her message is about the life-saving gift of organ donation. And then I got another push along the way to think more deeply about filmmaking and the stories that I would tell. My older brother had taken a risk with me when I was very young and green and really didn't know what I was doing. But he pushed a camera into my hands and said, "You can do it." But he was diagnosed with a cancerous brain tumor, and it was the scariest thing that I ever had been through in my life, was just fearing of what might happen to him. And a few years later, I got an opportunity to make a film about young adults who had survived cancer. And the thing with young adults who survived cancer is that it really throws them off. It's like you're going along, you're getting ready for life, and suddenly this thing happens, and it's really hard. Even when you go into remission, it's really hard to get your feet back under you and keep going. But so the satisfaction, I want to ask the question is, what is the source of the satisfaction that we get from doing things where we're either mentoring people or trying to make the world a better place? And the question comes is, do you do it for yourself, or do you do it because you can actually do good? I think you can do good. But it doesn't always pay off. For the last 15 years or so, I've really devoted a lot of my energy toward mentoring younger, less experienced filmmakers, trying to get them started. And sometimes you expect a thanks or something like that. There was one film where I worked on it for 2 years, and then the project ran out of money, and so I had to move on and do other things. But someone I'd been mentoring took the film project on and finished it, and sort of put me in the credits, but you wouldn't be able to find it. And it really burned for a while, because here's this film winning major awards, and I'm watching it go by, and I have to just sit there quietly. So I had to really think about it, like, why do I do these things, and what is the source of the satisfaction? But as much as that might happen, there's also the opposite side of it, where you get a bonus unexpectedly. There's a film where I was working with a director and a producer who I just wanted to keep them happy, because I thought it was just so much fun to work with them. And when the film did finally come out, it was a great day, because they changed the credits around, put my credit first, and then when it won the Giant Screen Cinema Award for IMAX, they had the awards all duplicated and sent me one. And so that was the other side of that feeling. And also because of that, and showing up and just being psyched to work hard and make things happen, I'm proud to also be involved in this new film that's about to come out, about the American National Parks. It's another IMAX movie. And of course, I was doing what I love, which is hanging off of something with a giant camera. And then in 2010, I finally did it, and I got that picture. And now I don't have to go up that mountain anymore. So later that year, I did go back to the Himalaya and do one last climb. And this time it was a climb with military veterans returning from war. And it was the biggest and most challenging project that I've ever worked on. And I'll show you the trailer for that film.
You don't really quite even remember exactly what happened. And everything just went black.
Get up! You know, they ask you every year what you want to do when you grow up, and I said I wanted to fight in World War III. I guess I got my wish.
You don't build a soldier. All in all, you're training the guy to fight.
People still don't get it that not all pain is physical.
It's really hard to like re-establish yourself in society because it's just so different.
Man, some of us don't want to remember ourselves. We don't want to remember our memories. I want them gone.
It's like this deep, dark, black abyss that I stare into.
I think there are a lot of occasions in life you kind of have to reach your breaking point.
What are these people doing up here?
Up, looked out the window. The first words out of my mouth this morning were, "Holy sh!"
I look back on how I was as a sighted individual, and I look at it like, well, a blind person shouldn't be doing this.
Nice. Oh yes. Set. Strong.
The greatest hope is that these people that have been broken and beaten and blown up and shattered have the capacity to continue putting one foot in front of the other, and they don't need to stop.
I'm hoping that if I can successfully climb this mountain, that, you know, I'll be able to get on with my life.
Something unexpected happened as we were making this film. This story of veterans caught the attention of Hollywood, a Hollywood producer, and suddenly the film became much bigger than anything I'd ever done before, and the pressure was super intense. And it was an enormous privilege to be able to work on a film at this level. We had a named composer, we were mixing the audio at Skywalker Ranch, we had distribution deals and crazy film festival schedules. We had the film even played here in Seattle. And it was a lot. And I remember I was at one point sleeping on the floor underneath the editing computer while it rendered the files overnight. And then the editor would come back in the morning, we'd keep cranking away. But it was also just destroying my health, and I was eventually eating painkillers like as if they were popcorn, and it was kind of a downward spiral. And then I met a magical person. Whoops, sorry, don't need to see that again. Her name is Julia, and about the time that our son turned one, we were married, and Julia really saved my life. After being so deeply into this film, she pulled me back from the edge and helped me see that there was still a big world out there, not just this movie I was trying to finish. But since then, we've added another. And when I think about what lessons I want to give my own kids now from my own career, it's about looking for satisfaction from places inside of yourself rather than trying to find it from awards and what the outside world might give to you. And to also be willing to take risks for other people, especially when they're doing things like a blind man trying to climb Mount Everest, or a woman with a heart transplant trying to raise awareness for organ donation, or doctors doing surgeries in the developing world. So I hope that they can take those things into their own lives. And then I have one last thing. I have a challenge for all of you to think about, is just think of someone who you would love to see succeed. And then think about what risk you can take to help them. It doesn't have to be anything big and heroic, just some basic risk. Take a risk so that someone else can succeed. Thank you.